Welcome friends, today is the third video on my mini lecture series on clinical anatomy, and the topic of today's lecture would be on embryological basis of tetralogy of ferret. So let us have a look on the normal development of the heart tube. The developing heart tube has been divided into certain parts. It is like a vertical tube channel. Okay. In the distal part, it is known as the bulbous caudis. This is whole region is known as bulbous caudis, which has been divided into three parts: a proximal one third, middle one third, and the distal one third. The proximal one third will form the primitive ventricle, trabeculated part of the right ventricle, and the middle one third is known as the conus caudis, and it will form the outflow tract. It will form the outflow tract of both the right and the left ventricle. The truncus arteriosus, the distal one third part known as truncus arteriosus, will form the pulmonary artery and the aorta, ascending aorta. Next to it will be the ventricle. This region is known as ventricle, and it will form the primitive left ventricle. This part of it. Next part is known as atrium, and it will form the right and the left atrium. And next part is known as sinus venosus, which has been divided into two parts: the body of sinus venosus and the two horns, right and the left horn of the sinus venosus. When this longitudinal heart tube will fold on itself, it forms a U-shaped structure. Okay, and we are looking the heart tube from the lateral aspect. Okay, so when the heart folds on this, this is the atrium, and this is the ventricle part we are seeing, and this is the developing bulbous caudis region of the heart tube. Okay, so now we have to focus on basically on the interventricular septum and the conotruncal septum. So let us resume. If this is the part of the bulbous caudis and this is the developing ventricle, in the region of the truncus arteriosus, let us assume this is the region of the truncus arteriosus, a septum is formed, which is known as spiral septum. Okay, which is known as spiral septum or the truncal septum. This septum is spiral in shape and is formed due to the proliferation of two swellings, which is known as truncal swellings. Okay, and they are located in the right superior aspect and a left inferior aspect. They begin to join towards, unite towards each other, that in such a manner that the septum is in the form of a spiral. Okay, so and it will form the pulmonary artery and the aorta. Okay, and it forms in such a manner, you have seen it is forming the spiral septum, spiral in form. So it divides, if this is the tube, truncus arteriosus, a septum will divide into it two channels. If we cut at this level, the septum is in this manner. So anterior channel will be the pulmonary artery and the posterior channel will be the aorta. In the middle, the septum will lie like this, and towards the left will lie the pulmonary artery, and this channel will form the aortic channel. Above, it will again lie this, because septum is going like this. So now the aorta will come in front and the pulmonary artery will lie posteriorly. So in this way, this spiral septum forms. This is a photo of how spiral septum looks when we take some sections in the three regions. Now in the region of the bulbous caudis, another septum arises, which is known as bulbar septum or the conal septum. Okay, which will divide the outflow tract into two: the right outflow tract and the left outflow tract. Okay, so here will be the bulbar septum or the conotruncal septum, and this was the spiral septum. Here look that the bulbar septum will unite distally with the spiral septum to complete this channel. Okay, now this is the region of the ventricles. Okay, the two ventricles, the right and left ventricle, will enlarge so that the floor from the floor arises a septum, which is known as the muscular part of the interventricular septum. So let us assume this is the muscular part of the interventricular septum. Okay, but here lies a gap. This muscular part will not fuse with the bulbar septum. So this gap is filled by another cushion, which is known as endocardial cushion. Okay, which lies at the junction of the atria and the ventricle. This endocardial cushion will proliferate entirely. To fill this gap and will complete the interventricular septum by forming which part of the interventricular septum? The membranous part. So altogether that we can see the membranous part will be formed by the anterior proliferation of the endocardial cushion, AV cushion also, and plus apart from that, a small part of the bulbar septum, because it was dividing both the outflow tract. Okay, remember this fact when we will discuss the embryological basis of the heart. So this is the adult picture of the heart. This is the right atrium, this is the right ventricle, left ventricle, and the left atria. This is the pulmonary artery draining the right ventricle. This is the aorta, which is draining the left ventricle. This is the intramuscular septum. This was the two outflow part of the ventricles. This was the muscular membranous part of the interventricular septum. This is the muscular part of the interventricular septum. Now what happens in the tetralogy of Barrett? In tetralogy of Barrett, there is anterior displacement of this septum, the bulbar as well as the truncal septum. Okay, together both the septums, the truncal septum as well as the bulbar septum, are together known as conotruncal septum or the aortico-pulmonary septum. Okay, so this septum, this whole conotruncal septum will be anteriorly displaced. So what will happen if this anterior displaced? Now look at the lower part of this channel. Okay, I am enlarging this view. If this is the normal picture, this was the pulmonary channel, this was the aortic channel. If this septum is anteriorly displaced, now the septum comes here. So what is happening? What is the diameter of the pulmonary artery? It has narrowed down and the aorta becomes huge. This happens in pulmonary channels. And this anterior displacement is particularly at the level of the coronal septum. Therefore, and we all know the coronal septum divides the outflow tract of both the ventricle. So pulmonary stenosis will be more at the level of the infundibulum. Therefore, it is always written in brackets that it is infundibular stenosis, because this stenosis is happening at the level of infundibulum of the right ventricle. So let us make that picture clear. The pulmonary artery will become stenosed, narrowed down. Pulmonary artery has become narrowed, and the aorta has become huge, so huge that is now overriding the interventricular septum and also draining the right side also. Okay, you can see it is draining the right side also and the left side also. This is known as overriding of aorta, or the dextro position of the aorta. It is coming toward the right, dextro position of the aorta. Okay, now what happens after this? This pulmonary stenosis has occurred. This will lead to increased resistance at this level. This increased resistance will be carried backward, to the right ventricle. Now right ventricle has to pump more, so that blood can squeeze out of this narrowed channel. Okay, so there will be which will lead to hypertrophy of the right ventricle, which is the third feature of tetralogy of Barrett. Okay, now look into the fourth feature of the tetralogy of Barrett. I already told you the muscular part was formed by the anterior proliferation of AV cushion as well as the bulbar septum. Okay, so if this part has anteriorly displaced, okay, and problem with the bulbar septum. So there is a problem with the membranous part of the interventricular septum. There will be a gap between the right and the left ventricle. So this gap is known as ventricular septal defect. Blood will flow from the right ventricle to the left ventricle. So you have seen all the four features of the tetralogy for it. Pulmonary stenosis or the in at the level of infundibulum, which will lead to overriding of the aorta. That will lead to pulmonary stenosis, will lead to high right ventricular hypertrophy. And as the bulbar septum was, or the coronal tractus septum was defective, so the membranous part of the interventricular septum was also defective, which has led to ventricular septal defect. So I think you have now understood what is the embryological basis of tetralogy of Ferret. Thank you.